Last time you have been here in Budapest, 1972, how did your way of living and your way of thinking change in these 10 years?
I've become more dangerous and more reckless.
How you mean it?
Oh, yes. I was much more careful 10 years ago. And now I've changed into something very dangerous, very reckless, very volatile. No knowing what I'm going to do next.
But you didn't know before, did you?
No, never.
So, this is a way of changing your character?
Well, in a sense, yes. You understand as a certain kind of curious thing happens. You become rather more patient than one was. You become rather more tolerant, rather more compassionate about people and things and ideas and whatever it is. You certainly changed a great deal. I have no idea what I was like 10 years ago. The person that was here 10 years ago was, to me, a total foreigner. I don't know who he was.
And how did your way of living change?
No, it remains more or less the same.
How do you live?
Very well.
Thank you. In which country is your home?
Well, wherever the books are.
Where are they?
Well, there are two sets, three sets. One's in London, one's in Mexico, and one's in Switzerland.
And what is your home?
Wherever the books are.
So you have got three homes?
Yes.
How much time do you spend there in each?
Oh, very little. I work so much that it's very difficult to say where I live. I would say that fundamentally the basic home base is Switzerland.
How many time do you spend there a year?
Oh, I don't know. If I'm lucky, maybe 2 weeks. I live in hotels.
How can you do that?
I don't know. I've certainly become one of the world's greatest specialists on hotels. I can tell you what hotels are like. This is a great hotel. I mean, I don't know if it's a great hotel, but this is a great room. This is a great place. You see, at the edge of this hotel lives the Danube. And the other side of the river, as you know, is Buda. And here we live in Pest.
Thank you for the geographic description.
I would like geographical description, right?
Thank you. You were born in Vers. You are a Versman, aren't you?
Yes.
Would you tell me something about your childhood? How many people were there in your family? Would you tell me something about your father? Would you tell me something about your age till the age of 14, when you were at Jenkins?
Well, I've told the story so often that they bore even me, right? I'm one of 13 children. My father was a miner. My mother was a barmaid. And I'm the 12th of 13 children, four of whom are now dead. And so there's still quite a lot left around. As a matter of fact, it would be impossible, even in this fabulous hotel, it would be impossible to get all my family into this room. It's so enormous. The in-laws, the nephews, the nieces, and all that.
How did you live at that time?
Hmm?
How did you live at that time?
Well,
at the elementary school, at the secondary.
How did the family live, you mean?
How did the family, and how did you?
Well, the family, we had a little house, which had two rooms upstairs and two rooms downstairs. And so everybody had to switch around. It's very difficult to accommodate such an enormous family. And it was just enchanting, very happy childhood I had and all that. Certainly all the miners, they were all miners, you know, my
yeah.
Brothers were, apart from my younger brother, they were all miners. Eventually, they weren't miners, they became something else, they became very successful in other directions, but they started off being miners. And so there were two beds, for instance, in one room, and two brothers would sleep in the two beds, and the other two brothers would go to work. And my father and another brother would also go to work. And then they'd come home, they'd sleep in the two beds, and so they'd switch around. So the bed was always warm.
Could you tell me something about your father's character?
Well, he was adorable, charming, vulgar, sweet, intelligent, kind, generous, and had an extraordinary gift for words.
And towards children, how did he behave?
With a kind of bland indifference. He didn't quite know which one we were. There were so many of us. And I remember going home once to Wales, and I went to the house where my father lived, and I said to, in Welsh, Limavir, which means, where is he? And they said, where do you think? So I went to the pub, and he was sitting there by the fire, and he was a very small man, very powerful, but very short. He was sitting by the fire, and he was mulling his ale, you know, he had a pint of beer, and he had a poker in it, you know, to make it hot. And he said, he looked up, and he was slightly purblind from the coal dust, you know, coal dust gets into your eyes and makes your eyes red. And he looked up and he said, who are you? I said, I'm his son. And he said, which one?
That's it. I have heard that, so far as I know, your mother died at age when you were two, right?
Yeah.
So how come that you are Jenkins and you turn to be Burton? Would you tell me the story?
Well, it's a rather complicated story, actually, because what happened was that there was an Englishman called Burton, who was the senior master at the school that I went to, the secondary school. And I was applying to go to Oxford University. And the Welsh are quite clever, apart from the Italians, I should think. They're about the cleverest race in Europe. And so the Welsh were dominating Oxford University, so the Oxford people were trying to keep us out. And so it was suggested that it would be a good idea if I changed my name from Jenkins, which is a very Welsh name, to Burton, which is a very English name, so they wouldn't realize I was a Welshman when I went to Oxford. And so that's
But in our previous conversation told me that you had to leave the secondary for a while because the family was out of money.
Yes, I worked as a haberdasher.
How did you enjoy it?
Not very well.
So about how you started your actor career?
Ah.
About the career, how you started, the boring story for you. I would like to ask you. Yeah?
All right. Well, I got this entrance into Oxford University, but I was too young to go. I was only 16 years old. And a very unique thing happened. I think unprecedented, certainly in my world, an advertisement, because during the war, you must understand that all the young men were called up, they were drafted into the army or the navy or the air force, and so it was very difficult to find young men. And though I was 16 years old, I was exactly the same size as I am now, and I thought there was an advertisement in the paper which said that Emlyn Williams, the famous Welsh playwright and actor, was looking for a young man of 22 who could speak Welsh and who could act. Now, I knew I could speak Welsh. I wasn't too sure that I could act. Anyway, I applied for the job, and I got it. And it seemed to me the millennium. I thought it was the second coming, because they paid me £10 a week, and the top money for a minor in those days was £3 a week. So suddenly I got £10 a week. I thought the end of the world had come. And that's how I became an actor.
What did you read at Oxford, and for how long?
I was there only for 1 year, but it might have been 50 years. Seems a very long time. I read English and medieval Italian.
How come that you chose these subjects?
Well, English, for obvious reasons. Medieval Italian, because I was surrounded by Italians. In Wales, there are a great many Italians.
So what happened after the Oxford University? So far as I know, there was only one...
After Oxford University, the war was on.
Yeah.
So I flew in the Royal Air Force and the RAF, and I was a navigator in the Air Force. And I was in for like 3.5 years, something like that.
Where have you been as a navigator?
All over Germany. And actually, I was on my way to, like so many others, on my way to bomb the Japanese. And we were, as 'twere, province hopping across Canada. And we left Winnipeg and we were on our way to Calgary, I think, when the wireless operator said, the war's over. We dropped the atom bomb. I didn't know what the atom bomb meant at that time. I was 19 years old.
So this 3.5 years had no influence on your life later on?
Oh, yes.
What sort of influence?
I learned fear.
Did you? Mm-hmm. Well, after Player, you came back, you were in the theater again.
Mm-hmm.
And you played innumerable Shakespeare plays, right?
Well, I played quite a lot of them, yes.
You played Hamlet, both in England and both in the States, directed by Sir John Gielgud.
Well, the first Hamlet was at the Old Vic, and it was directed by a man called Michael Bentall. And then 10 years later, I did it again, because I didn't think I was very good. Actually, I think I was impersonating John Gielgud in the first Hamlet. The second Hamlet, he directed me in it, and I didn't impersonate anybody, I just did myself.
And what sort of difference between the two performances in the States and in England?
Well, I don't know how to describe it. I would say that the English performance of Hamlet was Italianate, you know, playing with very black hair, and terribly kind of melancholy and all that. The second performance was manic, demonic. It was absolutely me. I didn't bother with all the people I'd seen. Everybody derives from everything. If you write a line when you're very young, whatever you write, it derives from somebody, right?
Yeah.
Somebody taught you the language, right? And so as an actor, in the initial stages, you derive from somebody else, you copy somebody else until you find exactly your own style, and then it changes and you become absolutely yourself.
Could you feel any difference between the audience of the two nations, of the English audience and the American one?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Can you express it with words? What was it?
Well, the English are very reserved. As an audience there, they watch you. They're very nice. They watch you, and they're very, very clever, very intelligent audience. The American audience is not so intelligent, but it's much more generous.
How do you mean that?
There's a kind of warmth that comes from the Americans that the English don't have.
How come that you are playing recently, mainly in American theatres, and you never go to England?
Because I don't like to pay English taxes.
Money has got such a great important role in your life?
Money is the most important thing in the world.
Why?
Without it, we cannot live.
What do you do with your money?
Give it away.
For what?
To anybody. You want some?
Do you make any foundation? Say, for example, in the US, for the miners?
I'm not going to tell you anything about that. Of course I do. But do you mind if I smoke?
No, thank you.
I'm not going to drive the Hungarian children mad, am I?
As a matter of fact, when I met Sir John Gielgud in 1974, and we were speaking about you, he said that he got to know you as an extremely talented special actor of the theatre in 1949. And now he said that as soon as you finish your film, you begin the next one, you do not even see them, you do not even go to see the rushes, out of what an actor can earn quite a lot. He disapproved it.
Well, you must understand that John is a very old friend of mine and always been very nice to me. He was a great, great actor before I met him. And there's no way that John can possibly understand me, or indeed that I can understand John. John loves to see himself, as most actors do. I don't like to see myself. I'm not unique in that, I don't think. But I remember one day walking down Shaftesbury Avenue in London, and I saw John Gielgud coming the other way, and he was crying. Tears were pouring down his face. I said, "What's the matter, John?" He said, "I've just gone to see myself as Disraeli. I made it in 1936. I was hoping it had gotten better. But of course it hasn't, and I'm so sad."
So if you do not see yourself, who are the people whose opinion are interesting for you about your performance on stage or in film?
Well, I have possibly half a dozen friends, one of whom you met night before last, Cyril Cusack, it's Alec Guinness, and Laurence Olivier, John Gielgud, an actor that I don't think you've heard of called Robert Hardy, who's a very fine English actor, and they come to see me, and I go to see them, of course. And if I develop a mannerism, kind of thing that you do, you know, like at certain moments you pick this arm up and you do this arm out, you know, and they say, you must stop doing that because you're becoming mannered, as they say. So they correct me. So I have to take it.
Right? So then what do you think of the directors?
Directors are bus conductors.
How do you mean that?
Yeah. Most directors that I know, some exceptions, of course. I've done about 70 films, I think, something like that. And I've done about the same number of plays. And with the possible exception of about 7 directors, the rest are directors under false pretenses. They shouldn't be directors at all.
Who are these 7?
I'm not going to tell you.
Why?
Well,
why?
The other 140 would be very, very piqued. No, some of them are very fine. Mike Nichols, great director. John Huston, Marty Ritt. Quite a few.
So how can you do the play if you are on the stage? Do you direct yourself?
Well, you allow the director to tell you where to go because the lights are there or whatever is there, you know. But after that, you're on your own. I mean, the stage is vitally important. It's where the actor is totally his own person. He can change it. Night after night, he can change everything. Indeed, I do.
So how
I
do
think
you...
so. I set the place on fire, I think. No, what?
How do you change from the offer drawers then?
Hmm?
If the directors are not important, are your partners important for you, with whom you are playing in films or in theatre?
Oh, absolutely essential, yes.
According to what do you choose from the offer drawers?
I don't choose them. They choose themselves.
How you mean it?
Well, I don't cast, I don't say I want that one, that one, I want that one, whatever it is. If they happen to be there, and if they're good, then it's rather remarkable. I don't suppose anybody really understands the, the non-actors, people like you, people like you, don't understand actors at all. We are peculiar unto ourselves. We are unique unto ourselves. We're not true artists, I don't think. Maybe we're interpretive or something like that. Whatever it is that happens with an actor, most of the things that non-actors say or write about actors is always slightly false. Well, Jean Renoir, quoted by his son, Jean Renoir also, I've forgotten what the book's called, Mon Père or something like that, my father, and said that Jean Renoir said, an actor is something less than a man, and an actress is something more than a woman. So whenever one gets an observation from a foreigner about actors, they always denigrate the actor. They glorify the actress, not the actor. Because an actor puts paint and powder on his face and he chances around the stage and behaves in some extraordinary fashion, people are jealous.
Have you got an idea of an actor?
I have the faintest idea what they like. Actors are like fingerprints, like you, like everybody. They're all different.
You don't find that they are artists? Just that you think that they are interpreting?
I think that possibly at their highest point, they are artists. On the average point, they are merely interpreters. They just say the words.
And which are the highest points?
I know. It just so happens that at this time, this particular time, this particular point in eternity, I would say, but you must understand that I'm not prejudiced because I'm not English, I'm a Welshman, I would say that English actors are the best in the world.
Why? Why do you think it is?
It's a kind of renaissance or something in English acting. I mean, English actors now are so devastating, they're so brilliant. On all kind of levels, all kind of levels. And the depth of talent is so enormous. They're almost frightening.
Do you think that it has got something to do with the education of actors?
It may be the training, you know, you have to play Shakespeare, you have to play Goethe, you have to play all those people. I don't know, but they really are.
So then what is the real significance for acting for you?
I don't know.
Well, I know that you like to find out stories about it, but really?
Like what?
That is, acting is your hobby or making money and something like that, but would you tell me what is the real significance for acting?
Well, saying that acting is a hobby, which it is in a curious kind of way, is like saying that the blood happens to be running through my body. It pulses around and it's nothing to do with me, it's running around, so I'm an actor.
Have you ever thought of directing a play or a film?
I've directed both, very badly. I can't direct.
And you do not want to have a director career later on, do you?
No, I directed one film, it's called Faustus. Have you ever seen that?
No.
It's sort of interesting. Mahler's Faustus, not Goethe's Faustus. And I directed that. But I'm no good as a director. Because all I say is, this is the way I would do it, which is very bad for the actors. Because they think, I can't do it like that. We're all different.
Do you think that an actor can be a model of a society? Do you think that an actor can be a model of a society?
No. No way. I mean, I know that actors or actresses or whatever dominate fashion and the way you behave and so on, and people will copy Humphrey Bogart or Gary Cooper or Marlon Brando or Laurence Olivier or John Gielgud, whoever it is. They copy them, you know, the way they talk, the way they walk. In that way, they have, and the way they dress. In that way, they have a profound influence, but only on simple minds, not on proper people, not on.
Copy you?
No, I don't think it's possible to copy me because I'm different all the time. It's possible to copy Marlon Brando because he's always the same. It's possible to copy Paul Scofield, always the same. But I change. And if I play Henry VIII, you can't copy me as Henry VIII. What, you want a big fat belly? Or red hair, or a beard, or whatever it is. You can't copy that.
When you are playing the historical roles, but when you are playing roles of everyday people, and maybe yes, what do you think?
It's possible, I don't know, certainly not in my case.
Do you think that your way of acting is different to the people mentioned above?
Yeah.
If you know
what they do, some actors are very different from me. What they do is, they don't change into the person changes into them. And John Gielgud, for instance, can play Lear, can play Hamlet, he can play Prospero, he can play anything. It's always John Gielgud, always. The voice is always the same, everything's always the same. Beautiful, and fantastic, and brilliant to watch. But I change.
Did you ever improvise on the stage or in a film? I mean, mainly on the stage. For example, when playing Shakespeare.
Improvise?
Yeah.
Make it up as you go along.
Yeah,
oh, yeah,
anything.
Well, you know, I know I've ever told you this. It's quite interesting, really. I have a German daughter, adopted. And, you know, the Germans are very difficult bureaucratically to get the daughter. You get the daughter, you take her away, and she's 7 months old when she came to me. And it took me many, many years for her officially to become my daughter. And I happen to know Hamlet in German. I don't speak German, but I can speak Hamlet in German. And so I was playing Hamlet in New York, and the baby was, I suppose, about 7, 8 years old, something like that. And so all these Germans came over to see if I was a fit father for the child. She'd been with me for 7 years or 8 years. And so I was threatened by my wife, my then wife, called Elizabeth. She said, "Now you be nice. Be nice to the Germans." I said, "Okay." The Germans came over and they were very Germanic. And they came to see Hamlet, which the Germans firmly believe is a German play, rather badly translated into English by William Shakespeare. They firmly believe it's German. And so I got to the famous soliloquy, which is to be or not to be. And there were the Germans sitting, the five of them, the ambassador to the United Nations, an interpreter, a judge, a lawyer, I don't know, five of them. I came on the stage with a little book under my arm and said, Sein oder nicht sein, das ist die Frage. Ob Edler ihm gemut die Pfeil und Schleuder. I did the whole of To Be or Not To Be in German. And the audience took it. They were perfectly, and the Germans were delighted, and I got the baby. The two people who went mad were Claudius and the other person who was spying on Hamlet. Thought I'd gone raving mad. You can do anything with an audience. Once you have them, once you've got them in your fist, you can do anything.
How do you feel you have got them?
You just feel it. It's like animal.
You mentioned the name of Elizabeth Taylor. What sort of connection do you have with her right now?
Well, I talk to her virtually every day. And I'm very fond of her, and she is of me, I think.
The film, what you have done together, is they are all very popular here. Have you seen, by the way, The Taming of the Shrew?
Yes, I saw that.
And have you seen A Look Back in Anger?
No, I never saw that.
But you told me in our previous discussions a very beautiful story, how it was written. The connection with
Look
John
Back
Osborne.
In Anger. Yeah. Oh, I was written, yes. Well, it appears, though his book is there, as a matter of fact, John Osborne's book, and he doesn't say it in the book. And I think he's forgotten all of it. Maybe I misremembered, or my memory is distorted. Well, John Osborne was an actor, small part actor. He was never an important actor. And he was in a play that I was in. And one day I lost my temper with the director and became very angry. But I rarely lose my temper, once every 2 years or something. When I do, it's goodbye. And apparently Osborne was fascinated. And so he wrote Look Back in Anger. It wasn't called Look Back in Anger in the early days. It was called something else. And he sent it to me to read, and I read it. And I knew immediately that the man who wrote it was, I couldn't remember him at all. I didn't remember what he looked like or anything like that. I just vaguely remember. And I knew immediately that the man was extraordinarily fluent, that he had extraordinary currency for the language. But I said, and I wrote to him and I said, well, you're obviously a very considerable writer, but this man, this Jimmy Porter, will never do, because he's so lacking in charm. The audience will never take him. I mean, he's charmless. And I forgot all about it. I went to the United States and I was doing some play, I think, or film, maybe, in the United States. And I was coming back on the Queen Mary, one of those great big boats that the British have. And they have a little daily paper printed on the boat, which said, extraordinary controversy in London about a new play called Look Back in Anger, written by John Osborne. And I thought, I must go and see that. So I went to see it. And indeed, it was very controversial. I mean, people screamed at the actors. It was absolutely extraordinary to watch. And it went on for about 10 minutes, and I suddenly realized it was the play I'd been sent. And so now, it was a big hit in London. Now they were going to take it to New York. So they said, they asked me again to play Jimmy Porter. And I said, now look, I was wrong about London, but I'm not wrong about New York. It's bound to be a failure in New York. They'll never understand it in New York. Never understand. Totally different alien race. They will never understand it. Big hit in New York. Okay, so I lost out twice. So I said, now they asked me to do the film, and I said, okay, I'll do the film. The film was a failure.
Was it?
Well,
I mean it.
Not a commercial failure, complete commercial failure. It took five years to get the money back. But artistically, of course, it was successful, and I'm very glad I did it.
You have other friends who are writers and poets, for example, the youngest in the Westminster Abbey.
Well, no, I sort of was a very small boy. I met my first genuine poet, who was another Welshman called Dylan Thomas. And I was 9 years old, and he was 19 years old. And I remember at that time he'd written a volume of poetry called 18 Poems. And my father said to him, how's the book going? He said, well, it's called 18 Poems, and so far we've sold 18 copies. Now, he was my introduction to the writing world. And then after that, I knew them all, T.S. Eliot and Yeats, Auden, Spender. And every time I see Spender, I remember one of his poems. And I look at him in a kind of awe, because those lines are etched in the history of mankind forever. As long as the language lives, so will Spender's lines live. So whenever I see him, it's a slight taking away of the breath, right? Because he wrote those lines, he said, born of the sun, he's talking about mankind, I mean, the great people of mankind. He says, born of the sun, they traveled a short way towards the sun and left the vivid air signed with their honor. Now those lines will go down forever and forever and forever in history, right? So when I see something like that, faintly breathless, as if somebody took my stomach away.
What sort of influence they have got on you later on? For example, the friendship, as it were, between Dylan and Thomas and you.
Well, Dylan, it's very difficult to describe Dylan, because a man of such extraordinary genius is very difficult to capture, and it's like water. You can't catch it in your hands. It's like trying to eat, I don't know, to eat something volatile with a fork. A very extraordinary man. And whatever you said to him, if he'd had his hair cut, for instance, you'd say, Dylan, you've had your hair cut. He says, yes, let me tell you about the barber. Let me tell you about the barber. And then he'd suddenly spin this extraordinary tale about the barber. And you're absolutely fascinated for 2 hours, right? He never stopped. You couldn't really get near him as you can to most people. He was a genius. He inverted the metaphor, you know, he twisted everything upside down.
You were living with him for a while, weren't you?
Well, we were doing a poetry reading together, and he was reading Shelley, and I was reading Keats, I think. Not sure, the romantic poets. And I said, Dylan, what, we were in London. I said, Dylan, where are you staying? He said, I don't know. I said, well, you might as well come home with me. Right? So he came home and he stayed for 6 months. He was enchanting. I never saw him eat. I never, ever saw him eat.
What did he do then?
Drink.
What?
Anything. Except water.
And he was smoking cigar, wasn't he?
Eternally, yes. I never saw him with a cigar. I don't know. And I remember one day somebody said to him, we were doing a radio broadcast. The radio was very important, was very important in England. And the director of this particular thing, which is called In Parenthesis, said to Dylan, now Dylan, my dear chap, you're in no man's land between the Germans and the British, and you're dying, and you're a Welshman, and you're crying, screaming for your mother. And Dylan had a cigarette in his mouth. He said, okay. And that green light flickered, you know. And Dylan screamed. I mean, he screamed as you cannot understand the idea of screaming, except in nightmares or vast dreams. Tremendous scream. And with a cigarette in his mouth all the time. And he finished the scream and he turned to me and he said, I bet you couldn't scream like that with a cigarette in your mouth. Of course I couldn't.
But you were the one to whom or for whom he has written Under Milk Wood, I mean, to perform.
Now, the first voice he wrote for himself, second voice he wrote for me. And that, yeah, because he died, I played both.
Did you enjoy it?
Oh, yeah.
Would you tell me any of your favorite poems from Dylan Thomas?
Oh, I would say that, I don't know, he wrote about half a dozen lyrics, I think, which are remarkable. Will last, indeed, as long as the race lasts. I won't bore you with the whole poem, but there's one called Fern Hill, which is about Dylan's, all of Dylan Thomas's great poems are about his lost innocence, his lost childhood. He always refers back to his childhood. And Dylan, you know, firmly believed that when he went to sleep as a child, the entire physical universe disappeared. Everything went. And he was left suspended in some sort of strange space of his own invention. And also, Dylan never says going to sleep, he says riding to sleep. Because in the next room was his dotty grandfather, who forever was riding an imaginary horse through the middle of the night. So Dylan says, part of the poem. Says, all the sun long it was running, it was lovely, the hay fields high as the house, the tunes from the chimneys, it was air and playing, lovely and watery and fire, green as grass. And nightly, under the simple stars, as I rode to sleep, the owls were bearing the farm away. All the moon long I heard, blessed among stables, the nightjars flying with the ricks, and the horses flashing into the dark. And then, to awake, and the farm, like a wanderer, white with the dew, come back. The cock on his shoulder, it was all shining. It was Adam and Maiden. Not bad, is it?
Great. Great to hear. So far as I heard, you were in February in London when he was taken to Westminster Abbey, weren't you?
Yes, I was there. Yes.
You were doing a reading there of Dylan Thomas.
I did under Milgrove. I did same thing as usual.
How long ago have you been to London before this?
Oh,
for reading,
I was there. Oh, to work, I mean.
Yeah, to do this.
Oh, maybe 4 years or something like that.
Was it shocking for you? Was it a great experience?
Well, it was great to be back with my own people because everybody in that particular production was Welsh. And for the most part, they spoke Welsh, which is a very different language from English, as you know. And I was absolutely marvelous because the Welsh accent when they speak English is very different from the way the English speak English, if you know what I mean. So, I mean, Dylan himself spoke with a Welsh accent. So when another kind of illustration of Dylan's inversion of the metaphor is a famous poem of his called "And Death Shall Have No Dominion." Says, now you listen to just the first stanza. He says, "And death have no dominion. Dead men, naked, they shall be one with a man in the wind and the west moon. When their bones are picked clean and the clean bones gone, they shall have stars at elbow and foot. Though they go mad, they shall be sane. Though they sink through the sea, they shall rise again. Though lovers be lost, love shall not, and death shall have no dominion." Now, he says, "And death shall have no dominion. Dead men, naked, they shall be one with a man in the wind and the west moon." Now it should be the man in the moon and the west wind. He twists it round, turns it inside out. It's a kind of wittiness of his. He's a witty poet.
You do write yourself, don't you?
Oh, yes, very badly.
What are your writings? What are they about?
I can't write poetry, I'm afraid.
What do you write?
I write short stories, or I may write about you tomorrow. What about all of you?
Has it ever been published?
Oh, yes.
Where?
All over. I don't know about Hungary, but...
Not yet here.
No. I tell you, one of the greatest thrills of my life was about 5 years ago when there was an anthology of short stories in German for school children to read, right? A set book, as they say in English. And there were short stories by Tolstoy and Dostoevsky and Zola and Guy de Maupassant and Dickens and Hemingway and O. Henry and all kinds of people, and me. Now, if you come to my house, that book is all over the place. 20 of them. Great thrill.
Being an avid reader, what are your choice of books?
Everything and anything. The other day I was sitting here and I suddenly ran out of reading matter. So I picked up the Hungarian telephone directory. Absolutely fascinating. Fascinating. Read the names. They're fascinating.
Would you tell me an everyday of yours, one of your days? Would you tell me what are you doing when you are not filming, when you are not shooting a film?
Well, I read a great deal. I don't go out very much because it's rather difficult, in my case, to go out.
Why?
Because a lot of people know who I am. So it's very difficult. I sometimes do go out. Not very often, though. But mostly I stay here. I stay here, wherever I am. I stay in the room. And
isn't it like being in a prison, that you cannot go out for a walk?
No, it's a private and personal prison. That's like a prison, not like the partisans or anything like that, right? Being tortured or something.
So being a star is not dangerous to being an artist?
I mean, what?
Being a world star is not dangerous for anyone, for any actor, for being an artist.
It's a peculiar and potent and deadly mixture. It's very difficult to be a star and to be an artist. It's almost impossible to be both. Very dangerous.
And what is in your case?
Very dangerous.
How would you describe yourself?
Very dangerous.
Are you a star and you are the artist at the same time? How could you arrange it?
Well, I don't know. I think that's something we'd write a book about that.
How would you describe your personality? Because we read the papers here sometimes, we get from your country. We read about the scandals, we read about divorces and meeting and this sort of stuff. But it's very difficult to form an opinion what is true out of these gossips. So far as I know you are a totally different personality what I've read about you in the press. Am I right thinking that?
Well, the press, you know, invents you. From the word go, when I was a very young actor, I think it was you who quoted Kenneth Tynan to me the other day, right? When I was, I don't know, 23 or 24 years old, Ken Tynan said, and he was a friend of mine, I mean, he's dead, and he said something about me, I've forgotten exact words, but he said something like, Richard Burton is this, 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 and this. He is perhaps the Edmund Kean of our time. Now, Edmund Kean is the greatest English actor who ever lived, apparently. Right? But Edmund Kean died of drink when he was 39. So already they'd made up their minds about me. They'd already set the pattern. They decided that I was this wild, reckless, idiotic creature who's going to drink himself to death and make love to all the women in the world and all that kind of stuff. They set the pattern. I didn't. I'm totally different from that.
You gave no reason to that.
What?
You gave no reason for this.
No.
Not at all?
No. I don't think I did. Not at that age. And they can, of course, the press is enormously powerful, as you know. And they can change you. They can change you into their image of you. So that eventually you start doing things to please the press. I don't mean to please them, but to
feed them?
Yeah. So they want me to be wild, I'll be wild. They want me to be drunk, I'll be drunk. They want me to make love to women, I'll make love to women.
You have got nothing to do with it?
No, it's a totally different
with
person.
With your image?
No. It's not me at all.
We were so happy to know that you enjoy your staying here in Hungary and you like to come back here. So what are your impressions here in Hungary after 10 years?
Well,
why do you like to be here?
I think it's an extraordinary place and I love it. And I'm very conservative in the sense I come back the same. So you remember, Julia, 10 years ago I lived in exactly the same suite, exactly the same hotel. And I don't change in that sense. But Hungary, you know, to we poor people from the West is a very special name, it's a very special word. You see, Poland means nothing. Russia means nothing. Yugoslavia means nothing. Hungary, the sound of the word is extraordinary because the connotations in English are so special. Hungary, hunger, a desire for food, a desire for whatever it is. Hungary, the last great horde who swept across Europe, the Magyars. Hungary will always hold in the world's mind, certainly the Western world's mind, something very special, something very strange about Hungary.
Since you have been here the second time right now, earlier you have been here for 3.5 months, I think that beside the word, what you enjoy so much, Hungary, hunger, there is something else what you like here, perhaps.
Well, I don't know Hungary terribly well. I know Budapest.
Yeah.
And Budapest, as you know, is famously described in Western literature anyway as the Paris of the East. What they really should say is that Paris is the Budapest of the West. But it's a fantastic place, and the people are so extraordinary. Their faces are so wonderful and alive and rich. There's nobody quite like you, apart, of course, from the Welsh.
So I would like to finish this conversation with that. We do not have to wait another 10 years till you come again to Budapest. So, Gyorgyan Vaurian, am I right pronouncing?
Well, if somebody said to me, you are now doomed to live in one place only for the rest of your life, where would you like to live? And I would say, Hungary.